against Poland's Renata Napek-Miaska.
And there are both experimented fencers. They are fencing in international competition for a long time. Once again, I expect this match to be also very technical. They know each other.
So semi-final number two, Dennis Nyong refereeing this match. And it's Differt from Estonia on the right-hand side up against Napek-Miaska from Poland on the left. Tough one to call, this one, Amber.
No, it's okay. It's not the worst. And they are also both really nice fencers, you know, with ethics and fair play behavior.
Yes.
So it's great to have them.
Estonia have had a pretty good time since winning their first medals in the Olympic Games. Lehis winning the first medal for Estonia in fencing in Tokyo. And then
the team
doing, well, the big one.
Yeah, I think in Estonia they had a very good period with these different fencers, and the level could go higher and higher because they were really fighting among each other. And we can see the result. I mean, it's great fencing that they are producing.
And for a small country, quite a high level of high-level fencers.
It's
strong. 5, 6, 7 fencers? Women especially.
But they also have now men fencing very well. And we can see that actually the junior men are coming stronger and stronger. And there is clearly a difference of size that Ms. Differt has to be aware and to be careful about.
So we talk about this in commentary a lot, the size of the fencers, and oh, he's a big one, Burrell is huge, and does it actually make a big difference, or does it only make a difference to your style of fencing?
No, it makes a difference, but it's not. It's kind of an advantage to be taller because, you know, your distance is not the same and the size of your arm. So it's important. But it doesn't mean that because you're tall, you're going to win.
No.
And we know that because a lot of fencers are not the taller one in the world and they can still win both, hopefully.
So it does make a difference in terms of... So Fiammingo tends to fence outside a distance and then jumps in. Whereas the taller fencers, Sun, for example, the Chinese fencer, she's quite happy to stand almost at any distance.
Yeah, that's true, because you still need space to be able to move your tips or your arm. But you also have shorter people that are happy to fence with a bigger distance than the opposite.
Yeah.
So that really depends also on your fencing style.
Yes. But as we like to say, anyone can fence. Doesn't matter what shape or size you are.
Exactly. That's why I think fencing is an amazing sport for that. You know, you don't need to be the tallest one. You can just be also smart or more physical, more tactical, more technical. I think fencing is really a complete sport.
Universal, yeah. Even I could fence, well, until I turned 50.
You did fence.
A long time ago. No one wants to see that.
Maybe we can find out some videos. And
okay.
The first passivity is coming, 1 minute without heat. And the new rules of passivity is it does not matter the score of the fencer. Both fencer will get P yellow card, P passivity card. And then it will be a P red card, and then we will go to black. So for the first yellow and red, does not matter the score, both fencer will get the card. And for the P black, only the fencer with the lowest score will receive it. And in case they are both equal, both fencer will receive the black card, but the highest seeding ranking will win the match.
Okay, so I spoke to your colleague David Baker yesterday, I said, what do you do at the end of the match when you have to give a feedback? And he said, call DT.
Yeah, exactly. That's the correct answer, because if the score is not equal, it's easy. The one who will win is the leader of the score.
Of course.
But if the score is tied, we don't know the ranking by heart. Personally, there is way too many fencers for me to remember that. So the decision belongs to the technical directory. We will ask him, and
the
they will say
the organizing committee there. Yeah. And so you would go to the DT to call this?
Probably the DT for the final and will be close to the piece.
So here we go. It's the second period of the women's semi-final here. Number two, Renata Napek-Miazga against Nelly Differ. Poland versus Estonia. 3-3, and we've had a passivity card. Amber, you very eloquently told us the rules of passivity, but it's changed from last year.
It did. And actually, I think it's more simple now to understand it. And we go directly from yellow, red, black, and not the yellow, red, red, black that we used to have.
So just one red card and then straight to black.
The difference is also, does not matter the score, because fencer will receive the first yellow and red.
So tell me, from my ill-educated position, doesn't make such a difference. Ah.
Another one. So that's the P red card we were talking about. And because it's a red card, both fencer will also have a hit against them. And they will start again from the en garde line. So if there is again 1 minute without hit, both fencer will receive a P black card. But normally we won't get through that because they know it's not a good deal for the weakest ranked one.
Yeah, well, Napek-Miazga is the highest ranked fencer, so Differ has no choice here. She has to push.
Yeah, especially now that the score is different.
So we've finally got an intriguing situation with this penalty situation. We haven't seen it so much through the season.
No, that's true. I think maybe the fencer are less willing to play with the passivity because it's now shorter than before. And also
and
because
it
goes...
the whole idea was to make them fence.
Yeah, exactly. That's the point of... It's a combat sport, so they have to fight.
But now we have a tight situation. Napek-Miazga seems to be the one that's pushing back. Actually, Differt has taken the lead here. Nice and locked half.
Yeah, that's why it's a nice parry post to touch.
On guard. Prep. Ali.
But yeah, I was going to say, doesn't it make more difference in the team competition, this new rule?
I think they are less looking for the passivity, actually. But often still, at the beginning of the match, we still have this period, this 1 minute period where they are looking at each other and often we do have passivity.
Yeah. The day I think we've seen at the beginning of fights, you get that 1 minute, they get the passivity card and then someone tries to do something. The more experienced fencers seem to, in the last, when it gets to 51, 52 seconds, they tend to go for a hit to stop it.
Was that really the only, the beginning of the match, this observation phase? And then I think now we do have a lot of fencing, more actions.
Yeah, I think the concept of this stopping them from bouncing around for 3 minutes doing nothing, the idea of the rule is a good rule. And I'm not...
It's effective.
Exactly.
It is.
I'm not entirely sure how the adaptation of taking the one red card out is making a big difference, but you've told me, the other referees have told me, it's making a big difference.
Yeah, and also, you know, by team, now we don't have these pit black cards that allow you to make the substitution entering the match. It's more fair because when you had, for example, a team with three person and the other one with four, you start with an advantage and that's not normal.
So here we are, second semi-final, all square here between Differt and Napek Miasca. Napek Miasca here taking on a little bit of fluid, but seven apiece. And to be honest with you, you talked about in the first semi-final, it stayed quite central, quite in the middle. This one also.
That one also, I think we had one action on the right, completely on the right of the piece, one on the left. And as we say, also very technical ladies trying to hit the main, the closest part of the body, like hand.
Yeah, trying to hit on the inside. Here we see Differt perhaps been a little bit in the shadow of Believa, Kerpu, Lehis, of course. And now on the main piece, in the podium here in Budapest.
Pause your match.
And we start again for the third period. So both fencer have this P red card, meaning that we will see more action now in the last period.
Oh, I think so. And it's got to be Differt that's the one that pushes a little bit more because she's the lower ranked fencer. If we have a minute without any fencing, she's out.
And, so she has this pressure. But also, we can see that Knapik is not willing to give her the piece. She's pushing, but it's also tactical for her to push. And we have a double hit now.
Estonian coach looking a little nervy here. So Napek Miasca still pressing.
It's also tactical for her because if she wants 1 minute to pass, she also has to lead with the field, even if it's really unlucky that we have 1 minute without hit. And distance is really, really close.
Yeah.
And I'm not sure that Napek is using her size yet, because she's pressing and pressing her opponent.
And not using that long distance because she's taller. Yeah.
And the score is still tight.
But the advantage is with the pole. It's interesting because last season we saw the Polish team, the women's team, doing so well.
Now that's a nice action. And Differt is asking for video.
For what?
I think the referee will have to focus on the halt timing, and also is she turning back or not.
Yeah.
That's often a problem, you know, with left-handed and right-handed fencers.
Looked
because
okay to me.
If, for example, the right fencers goes on the back of the left fencer, it's not the fencer turning back, it's just like the opponent going on her back. And in this case, it's not a mistake, because it's the mistake is really turning the back to the opponent.
Yes.
And sometimes can happen that your opponent is going on your back and it's not your fault.
I think the easiest.
So that's a halt. That's probably for the Korakor, but let's see what's going to happen next.
Korakor is what?
Korakor is the main part of the body touching the other main part of the body. Sometimes for, you know, very tiny contact, like knees to knees, we don't say halt.
But if you're chest goes to chest, you stop the fight.
Yeah, we must say halt, but it's literally the halt of the referee that stops the bout and not the contact. So on this action, referees, Leon say it's just halt on a good timing, you know, with the contact. That's why the hit was not given. And Miss Knappik is leading by two right now.
Nice little hit as well. Nice little Cyclocese flick to the wrist. For those in the know, for those in the vernacular, little circular movement of the blade and a flick over the top. Too far?
It's never too far, you know it.
It looks too far from me.
I saw the score.
She's attacked with Octave, a big blade movement.
That's right, I thought you meant the score because we could see in the last match that the score is never, the match is never over until the end.
No, but in the final minute, three hits in Epe is huge.
It's huge, but we know it's possible.
Four is even worse.
That's true, but 48 seconds is still very long. But once again, she has to avoid the double, so it's really hard.
Yeah. But we saw her come back from 14-11 in the last semi-final, and now 13-10.
You would be happy with a comeback again, huh?
I think I might be. Yeah. Impartially. I'm
of
not supporting
course, that's just
one
for the
or
tension.
The other. Yeah, yeah.
Just like, I think in fencing, we have this moment like with more subit, sudden death, and with equal score at 14-14. That's so emotional that everybody likes this moment. Yeah. Maybe not the fencer.
Maybe
lose,
not the referee.
No, the referee also. It's, you know, the fencers, they like to fence for the tension, for the emotion, but the referee is the same. We are also looking for this kind of adrenaline. And once again.
Look at this. Amber Siviero, you must come back to the commentary box every time you're at a competition.
It's the fencers on the pist did the action. Not me, I'm just
you're
happy
making
to 14, see
14 happen twice already. I think it's going to happen.
That's really nice catch up. That was a very great parry riposte.
Nice little octave riposte there, yeah. Really nice.
And now the score is tight again. 20 seconds to go.
Differt. Wow, I was just about to say, Differt seems to be pressing, but she's just decided to back off.
That's often the problem. You know, when you catch up the score, most of people think, oh, yeah, I've done it. But it's not enough. You need to score one more hit. That's why I really appreciate the end of the match of Kuhn, because she equalized, but she went for it.
She pushed, yeah. It's interesting, isn't it, that if you're four or five hits behind and you get level and then you just decide, okay, that's fine, I'm finished now.
And that's a common mistake. So the priority is on the left side. They do have 1 minute to score. The first one scoring is going to win.
And no score?
And no score means that Knappik's going to win, but right now it's a double hit. It does not count, of course, because it is a priority minute. Once again, a double hit.
It's close though, wasn't it?
True. What the referee should pay attention at this moment is the distance. And that's exactly what he asked the fencer for, because it's a tricky moment. So you really, they are not starting at 4 meters away because that's only at the beginning of the match. But you really want them to not be able to touch the point at the beginning of the match.
They're both going for it, aren't they? Do you feel the pole is just containing?
No. Once again, that's impressive. So Differt is really going for the hit. And we talked about that later. The fencer need to be active. And right now we can see that Differt is really, really active for the hit. That's a very tense end of match.
She keeps going octave, though. She keeps going, taking the blade and going into the low line, doesn't she?
Yeah, but probably Knappik will go for the hit soon because Differt is leading a lot. There she's going.
She saw. She predicted this octave, and she went round it.
Yeah, that's a great movement. She was right to do that because Difford was, you know, making pressure, and the distance was very close. So she did well to start. We can see that.
Brilliant stuff there from Renata Napek-Miaska. She goes through to the final of the Women's Epee Grand Prix here in Budapest. So Napek-Miaska will face Anna Kun in the women's final. Brilliant.